Hello, how are you doing? Paper one is now done with and we're focused now on paper two and paper three. And that is what today's video is about, paper two and paper three. So these are questions that are likely to come up in a calculator paper. And for all of these things that I'm going through today, I've put together a little bank of practice questions at my website, which is mathskitchen.com. It's all free and it's interactive, so you type in your answers and you can see straight away whether you got them correct or not. And there are model solutions showing you how to do it if you're stuck or if you make a mistake. So be sure to get over to there and have a bit of a practice. So I'm going to go through five things today. And in fact, I'm going to do a second part as well. That'll be up next Tuesday. But five things today, and for each of them, I'm going to go through them one by one. I'm not going to go into great detail, but I am going to give you, if there are relevant sort of little tips that can just help you with those questions, I'm going to mention that. And for each of them, I'm going to give you some examples of the sorts of ways in which those questions might be asked. So, without further ado, here are the five topics that might come up. We've got those sort of speed or density questions, compound interest, and then we've got trigonometry, or you know, you might refer to that as Sokotoa, and then finally iteration is the only one that actually I might go through in a little bit of detail, because I suspect you might not have seen that as much, you might not even have been taught it, but I think it's well worth having a little look at. Right, that is it, let's get stuck into them then. So the first thing, speed and density type questions. Speed and density are two examples of what we call compound measures, where you're combining two different measures. So speed, for example, is you're combining distance and time. You know, how long does it take you to go a particular distance? Density is the same. We're combining mass with the size of something. In other words, what is the mass for a particular size? You know, a piece of wood might be, you know, 0.6 grams for every cubic centimeter of wood. So if it's a speed question, you may well be asked to find an average speed, or you might be given an average speed and you need to use that to calculate a particular distance that someone might have traveled on a journey, something like that. My tip for these is to try, at first at least, to use a kind of common sense problem solving approach. So just remember that speed is just a measure of how far you travel in a particular time. For example, 80 kilometers per hour just means in an hour you would travel 80 kilometers. So you may, just by bearing that in mind, using a bit of common sense, you may just be able to problem solve these questions without going straight to using a sort of formula, or maybe a formula triangle some people use. Those are fine ways to solve these as well, but my first port of call would be to try and just sort of problem solve it using a bit of common sense. And then secondly, when you have your answer, use a bit of common sense again and just think, does this seem about right? You know, that maybe someone, you've worked it out, somebody's walking 2,000 kilometers in an hour. You know, that's you've obviously made a mistake there. So just at the end, double check, does this seem like a sensible answer? So the second thing, compound interest. So this might be a reasonably straightforward question where, you know, they might give you two different offers that a bank is making with, you know, different interest rates, and it's asking you to compare those things. And if that's the case, it's a reasonably simple process. You might find it useful to use a multiplier. So for example, if you want to increase something by 18%, you multiply by 1.18. and that will increase it by 18%. If you want to do that over multiple years, so let's say something is going to increase by 18% every year for 3 years, you would multiply it by 1.18 cubed to the power of 3. And however many years you are doing it for, that determines what your index number is. Which brings me on to the second way that they might ask these kinds of questions, and I'll illustrate this with an example. So they might say that somebody has invested £12,000 for 3 years, and at the end of that 3 years they've got £13,891.50, and we've got to work out what the interest rate was for those 3 years. So we remind ourselves of how we would calculate this using a multiplier. So what we would have done would have been 12,000 times something cubed, because it was 3 years, And the answer that that would give us is 13,891.5. So now we've got an equation that we just need to solve. I'm using x to describe that multiplier. So to find out what x is, we would divide both sides by 12,000. And that'll tell us that x cubed is equal to 13,891.5 over 12,000. And then we need to do the cube root of that to find out what x was. And that gives us 1.05. And 1.05 represents a 5% rate of interest. Next up is trigonometry, or SOHCAHTOA, as you might know this. That's a little mnemonic that we use to remember when to use sine or when to use cosine or tangent or sin, cos and tan, as they're written on your calculator, aren't they? So we use this with right angle triangles when we're trying to find either a missing length or a missing angle. And again, this question may be pretty straightforward, just here's a triangle, find out the missing length, or here's a triangle, find out a missing angle. The only thing I would say to look out for is sometimes it's not immediately obvious that it's a triangle. It may be a quadrilateral that's been divided into two, which is obviously just two triangles, but it may catch you out because you're thinking, well, that's not a triangle, that's some kind of quadrilateral. And then finally, the only thing to look out for is sometimes with those kinds of examples, you have two triangles and you'll need to use a bit of trigonometry or Pythagoras to find one length of the triangle before you can then find out another length. Okay, so trigonometry, SOHCAHTOA. I'm not going to go into any more detail because there are about a million videos on YouTube explaining how to do that. So if you're still struggling with trigonometry, SOHCAHTOA, go and check out one of those videos. The final thing I would suggest is iteration, which can be a bit off-putting because of the way that the questions look, and the mathematical symbols and language that is used can be a bit off-putting. But I think actually these aren't as bad as they look, and it's worth spending a bit of time trying to get to grips with them. Even if you can't do the whole question, there may well be a big chunk, you know, two or three marks that you could do pretty easily. So here is what a typical question looks like. This is taken from 2017 EdExcel. So you can see it says using x n plus 1 is equal to negative 2 minus 4 over x n squared, with x 0 equal to negative 2.5. Find the values of x 1, x 2 and x 3. So it looks terrible, but really it's not that bad. All you're doing is substituting numbers into a formula. So you can see where it's got that xn squared in the denominator of that fraction. You're going to substitute numbers into that and you're going to get an answer. Then that answer is the bit that you substitute back in next time. So it's saying to start with negative 2.5. So we're just doing this on a calculator. I need to type in negative 2 minus 4 over negative 2.5 squared into the calculator. When you're squaring negative numbers on your calculator, you must put them in brackets. Otherwise your calculator works it out slightly differently to the way you think it will. So you must do that. Then you can see if I hit equals, it gives me the answer there, minus 2.64. All I've got to do, so that's the first answer. The second one, all I have to do, I'm gonna go and replace that negative 2.5 with the answer that I just got, in other words, with negative 2.64. So I go back, type that in, hit equals, and that gives us our second answer. And I need to then put that back in, and that will give me the next answer. So that's a little bit of a mouthful, isn't it, that answer there. So I'm gonna do this little trick, which is I'm just gonna go back in, delete the previous one, and I'm just gonna press that ANS button. And that will put in the previous answer for me. Press equals, and I get the final one. So that is it, that's how you do those. And that was 3 marks for that part of the question. So if you think of it, it's just substituting numbers into a formula, but then your answer gets substituted back into the same formula, and then that answer gets substituted back into that same formula. You just keep repeating that process. That is iteration. So not quite as bad as it might at first appear. So that's it, my 5 tips for sensible things to revise for the calculator papers. As I say, they're not predictions. I don't know what's going to come up, but those things are really well worth revising. As I also mentioned, I'm going to be doing a second part of this. That will be up next Tuesday, and as soon as I've done it, I'll be putting a link down below, and I'll pop one up here as well, so you can go straight to that. Good luck, keep working hard, keep revising, and don't forget to go to Maths Kitchen, where there is a batch of all of these sorts of questions for you to practice. Good luck, and I'll see you next time.